I was advised by the professionals to hold it like this. I've got to do my finger like this as well. We've had quite a year since last time we got together. While there were a lot of tragedies and heartbreaking sort of situation in across the world, but we've had interesting developments that we have participated in articulating the voice of reason, rationalism, humanism, and civilization, really, across the world. We've had situation in Paris with Charlie Hebdo. We've had the word came out in support of decent human values. We've had Iraqi citizens in millions came out in Baghdad and many other cities in Basra in support of secularism. And that's unthinkable. We've seen in Afghanistan that people have come out against misogyny and anti-woman groups in Afghanistan. And we've seen many other progressive and humanist sort of movements taking shape. And we in Britain, Council of Ex-Muslim and One Love for All, been part of that to be able to articulate that. In Britain, we've seen exposure of the Islamist narrative in universities and safer space, and his call for reform of that. We've seen also the pressure on the government to review the Sharia law. Recently, a letter was handed into Downing Street following many years of campaign to abolish parallel legal systems in Britain, and we've called for one law for all. So at the end of that year, we thought we'll come together. We've seen the campaign to free Rauf Badawi in Saudi Arabia, and he represents many, many free thinkers, activists, secularists, labor activists across Middle East and North Africa, who actually languish in jail for just uttering and saying what they believe in. We've campaigned for that as well. So at the end of that year, we thought we'll come together not only to reflect on that, but celebrate our achievements and to look forward to a better year. But today, we have great speakers for you. We have beautiful music. And hopefully you'll enjoy your annual get-together. We expected Richard Dawkins to be here. He just sent us a message to say he just landed from, he just arrived from Stockholm and he can't make it. So he sent a message of solidarity. And he says, after a successful trip to Stockholm, I'm very sorry that I cannot be able to make to the wonderful party that you have. I would have loved to see old friends and the Council of Ex-Muslims and other secular groups and meet old and new friends. My best wishes to all of you and happy Newton's birthday. And for a better year in 2016. So that's a message from Richard Dawkins, but fear not. We have AC Grayling here who's going to speak and open today's evening. So Anthony Grayling, Master of the New College of Humanities, is a bastion of rationalism, reason, free thinking, and an excellent supporter of Council of Ex-Muslim and One Law for All. Ladies and gentlemen, Anthony Grayling.
Good afternoon, everybody. It doesn't seem like a year has passed since we were last gathered together, but it has been a very mixed year, in some respects a very dark and a very tragic year, and it's good to remember the fact that this is a struggle which is a real struggle with real costs. And there are lots of people in this room, people I know with very moving stories, who have to live with courage every day, who have painful memories to bear with them as a result of the fact that they've made a choice to live differently from the traditional ways of thinking about things. their refusal to accept constraints on their minds, on their feelings, on their lives, on their relationships with other people. There's a huge, huge body of courage in this room as a result. You know, you're standing next to people who have stories to tell which are really moving and really deep. And so we should congratulate one another, support one another, recognize this fact about one another. We know that we live in a country where, relatively speaking at any rate, it's safer than some other places. We look at our friends in Bangladesh, for example, who've really been at the forefront of difficulties. But we see, we know that it can be tough here too. I want to take my hat off to Maryam for standing up to a lot of bullying at Goldsmiths recently. You've all seen the footage. But this bunch of people are on the front line all the time, and my very, very, very warmest wishes to them for a much happier and a much more successful 2016. Let's remember this. The reason why we have lights and decorations and we overeat and we party and we have a little bit too much to drink and we give one another presents at this time of year is because of the shorter days. We go back in time, many, many, many centuries, long before today's young, rather oppressive religions got going. So we're going back now 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years. We're going back to a time when the dark and cold time of the year was a time of plenty. After all, the animals had been slaughtered, the meat had been pickled, the harvest was in, there was no work to be done in the field, so we could sit around, we could eat, we could drink, we could tell stories, we could have a good time, and because the days were dark, we liked to light a fire, we liked to have some candles burning, we liked to have a good time. Along came the religions and they hijacked it. Now we have to think, a little baby got born and therefore we've got to eat a turkey. The logical connection rather escapes me. But we shouldn't allow these traditions to be hijacked. We should enjoy this time of year, and we should take from it something which is of the very first importance in this great endeavor to make sense of life. We always praise reason and evidence. We praise rationality. You talk about institutions that are devoted to the idea of thinking. You're all very, very familiar with the Russellian point about, how few people do any serious thinking in this world of ours. He said, you remember, most people would rather die than think, and most people do, and consequently, of course, that's a source of great problems in our world. To get people to think and to be reflective and to really challenge their assumptions and to look at the world through clear eyes, the eyes of reason, that's something that we're very keen to see happen and which our education systems ought to be dedicated to instead of just reprising all those old views and ways of thinking. That's why we want to get rid, for example, of faith schools, so-called, although that phrase, faith school, seems to me to be a paradox in two words. But at the same time, it is reasonable to recognize that our emotional lives matter to us greatly, our affections and friendships, our love for one another, and those non-rational, valuable non-rational, not irrational, but non-rational things like hope and like courage. And it is actually hope and courage which is going to make this world a better place. The hope and the courage that we can make it a more rational place. The hope and courage to always strive to try to make people realize this one very, very fundamental fact, that when you meet another human being, you should meet them on the following terms, that it is another human being you're meeting, not a man or a woman or a this or a that or belong to that ethnicity or that religion, to refuse to accept the way people sometimes present themselves to us with some overriding statement of an identity that they want you to respect. No, you respect them as human beings, and most human beings do merit our respect. Remember what Emerson, the American essayist, said, we should give other people what we give a painting. That is the advantage of a good light. Always treat people with kindness and with respect to start off with, and only if they show themselves to be unworthy of it do we think about them differently. But if we began by encountering one another as human beings, forget about gender, sexuality, ethnicity, background, forget about anything else, just as human beings, one to another, feeling as we do, sometimes sad, sometimes happy, always striving and yearning, carrying some difficult memories, hoping, wanting to be loved, wanting to give love. If we think about other human beings in these terms, then it's always going to be Christmas. So my very warmest wishes to you all for a really happy and wonderful year next year. My great admiration to all of you, to Maryam, to her team, to the Council for Ex-Muslims, to the One Law for All, tremendously important, and it's great that that petition has gone in now. But let us hope that next year will be more peaceful, that more of us will be free of the trammels of difficulty and danger that too many of us experience, not us in this relatively peaceful part of the world, although some do, I think, but a better year all around, I very much hope, because I think, and this may be wishful thinking, but if you want to hear the argument, come and ask me afterwards, but I do think that the wheels of history are going in the right direction, even though it is a very rocky path. So, onward and upwards, happy Christmas to you all, and a happy 2016.
Thank you, AC Grayling. Beautiful speech to start today's program. Can I ask Aliyah Saleem to come and join us? She's campaigned for secular education, and she's one of the human rights activists that has worked with Council of Ex-Muslims and Wonder for All. Aliyah, thank you.
People that are so brave and are willing to work tirelessly. To just, you know, sort of say that it's been a brilliant year for me. I mean, as some of you might remember, the first time I ever spoke publicly was at a secular conference with Maryam. And, you know, because this is about celebrations, I wanted to speak about something that the Council of Ex-Muslims have helped me achieve, so many people in this room have helped me achieve, which was that, you know, I whistle blew on an Islamic boarding school. And the first person that ever looked at me and said, "I believe you," was Maryam. And it actually meant a lot to me, because you feel like, you know, people don't believe you. And this is something that's very important for ex-Muslims, apostates of all kinds, is for people to not undermine their experience. I mean, the school was re-inspected in April, and it went from a good to an inadequate. Something that... something that I always knew it was. So, you know, I've had a brilliant year. I've met loads of really young ex-Muslims, 16-year-olds, 15-year-olds, who are, you know, so intelligent, so brave, and so scared. And a lot of the times, all they want is for their parents to love them. So I think we need to kind of, you know, also appeal to people to make them understand that it's not about theology or, you know, whether God is real or not. It's about loving each other, as, you know, Professor Grayling said. So I'm going to sort of hand the mic back, but thank you all for all your support, and have a Merry Christmas and a good New Year's.
Now, next speaker is from Warwick University, president of the ASH at the university, who actually sparkled and started the whole debate about free space. Although he started with safe space. Did I say free space?
Yes.
Safe space. Actually, the debate has started with the, it had been rumbling for a while, and Dublin as well in Ireland, I think. But I think it came to a head at Warwick University. And I think he brought to attention of many people that actually there is something rotten in the state of some universities. And Benjamin was party to the discussion and exposing that situation. So can I ask Benjamin David to come and speak for a few minutes? Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that amazing introduction. I'm very amazed to see such a very proficient, very talented group of people. So I hope that I would just jump into my speech. The ultimate measure of a person is not where he or she stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he or she stands in times of challenge and controversy, said Martin Luther King Jr. And what a year of solidarity we've seen during times of challenge and controversy, especially during the fracas at Warwick University. I want to thank everybody who proffered their support to both Maryam and I when challenges and controversies were abound. For those unaware of the scandal, I asked Maryam to confer a talk to the atheist society that I preside over at Warwick University in order to put forth the ex-Muslim perspective to students. But Maryam was barred, and barred in the most reprehensible fashion by Warwick Student Union. I felt irate, embarrassed, and addled by the whole controversy. However, in the face of darkness, a monumental wave of camaraderie came to light. Lights carolled by fellow defenders of free speech, human rights, and pluralism. Many of whom stand here in this very room. Warwick SU had no choice but to retract their initial barring and issued a full apology. Both Maryam and I worked unremittingly to get their decision overturned. We really did, challenging their accusations, vindicating Maryam's reputation, and overthrowing their attempts to propound a sanitary university environment. The controversy, however, proved fortuitous. Our event with Maryam saw an unprecedented plethora of attendees, as well as accumulating a striking near 700 for CEMB. This was a triumph, a victory for the freedom of speech. However, in the face of victory, we must be vigilant, for there is many an important issue that we must construct a proactive platform for. And on such a platform, standing hand in hand, we will have the capacity to topple towering forms of regression and oust the ever-cradled stupor of otherwise intellectual people. I ask all of you here to be that platform. To be that platform that, for example, ensures that we become a society that safeguards people persecuted by those within their spume of religion, as well as those who have left their religion. To be that platform that ensures that people who are subjected to such iniquities and infractions are dispensed consistent, reliable support. The platform that ensures that the social shadows of God's demise is truly severed. The platform that ensures that such people are not inflicted with the same fate I was, stricken with mental illness, homelessness, and near oblivion. We must be that platform. I see so many proficient people here, people who really have the capacity to burgeon the surge of inspiration out there in our society. But a force of inspiration is nothing without the work, and the work is nothing without a united common bond. So I will end this by asking you all to let our bonds ascend us to great heights, and upon which I truly believe that we will reach beyond our imagination and effectuate truly monumental change. For one of the most fatal things that one can do is to try to stand alone. So thank you.
Benjamin, and thank you for the work you've done in the last year supporting free speech and questioning the tenets of safe space. Now, Council of Ex-Muslim is an important organization who's actually started the whole campaign for free thinking and ability for people to leave the religion if they want to. I'd like to ask Nahla Mahmoud, who is spokesperson for Council of Ex-Muslim, to come and join us. She is a human rights activist and environmentalist, among other things. Welcome, Nahla.
Hello, everyone. So whenever you think that you've seen all sorts of craziness in lives, Islamists surprise you. A Muslim scholar, Muhammad Taha, was charged of apostasy and executed hanging central Khartoum in 1985 for his critics of the mainstream Islam during that time, once said that whenever you think you've misjudged the Muslim Brotherhood, you will always discover that you've actually thought good of them. Two main things I'm carrying with me from this year, two main incidents with Islamists I'm carrying with me from this year. The first was a continuation of a bullying and harassment and sexist campaign by a former liberal Democrat counselor. He threatened me as an infidel who's deviating the youth and encouraging people out of Islam and encouraging drinking of alcohol in public. He used lots of my personal photos. Salah al-Bender. He used personal photos and segments of my articles and used my name specifically. The funny part, though, about all this is that the police, after taking so long time to get back to me, because the whole thing happened in Arabic, they said that whatever he's done is really not about me, regardless of the fact that he's using my photos, my name, and even recorded phone calls with my family. So it's slightly funny. And they sent me a letter with literally two lines saying, "We've investigated the matter. The guy is not guilty. We've closed the case." So that's one. Leave it on the side. Yeah. The second one is that I had to leave a place I've lived in after a few weeks from signing a contract for the harassment and intimidation I faced by Islamists in the neighborhood, Northwest London. And it's, if you're wondering about the place, it's one of those places where women, you rarely see women without a burqa, without wearing burqa. So you'll stand out if you're not wearing a burqa in that neighborhood. And prayers are called to using speakers. And sometimes the actual prayers are all done via speakers. So I've faced some intimidation, mainly by men, saying different sorts of stuff, you know, "God protect us from the devil," and, you know, "Go back, you Satan," and so on. But one particular incident was that a man stopped me and shamed me for how I'm dressed with very aggressive body language and told me that it's un-Islamic and inappropriate here. So, of course, I reported it to police. Not that I was expecting anything from them, but it actually got me thinking about, you know, teenage women, teenage girls specifically, and now that I take very good notice about what's happening around me and the neighborhoods and streets around me, I can tell this is not one place. There are other places that have very similar social and physical structure around London, at least. There will be people, there will be women that will never be able to see, we'll never be able to meet, we will never be able to interact with. Even those of us who come from Muslim background. So if I ask a quick question here, how many of you have friends and family members who wear the niqab? Okay, a few. How many of you have family members and friends who are Muslims? Almost everyone, yeah. So that sort of tells you that even though we are the ones who are most likely to interact with people who wear the niqab, we don't get to meet them, we don't get to see them. So bear that in mind. Now, I'm still hopeful. I'm still hopeful that things could change, and the change we're hoping for is feasible. And I have three main things I hope I will be working more on next year. First will be always secular education. Aliyah. Was Aliyah? Yay, secular education. And not only for children, all through, because we've seen all the hell that happened in Goldsmiths University. We need to create safe places where people can interact, can make friendships, can explore, question freely and openly. And secondly, is the more emphasis on equality and women rights, especially where religions, not only Islam, religions have strong social and political influence. We need more emphasis on women owning their bodies, having access, having the right and access to sex if they wish to safe sex, to contraceptions, to abortion, stopping child marriage and forced marriage, and banning the hijab for little girls school age. They are not They are not sexual objects. Little girls are not sexual objects. They're not there to seduce anyone, and they should not be covered. And banning the niqab for everyone. And I'll tell you what, I don't have that much time to get into the niqab, but the least I can say about it is that it is a physical barrier, it's a communication isolator, it raises lots of health concerns, particularly for those of us who got darker skin color. We don't talk about this. We need to be exposed more to the sun, not to cover up. And besides all of this, it's an insult to the humanity of these women, and it's a compromise to the value and quality of their life. So do bear that. The final bit, which are not in modern terms, as a choice. But I'm telling you now, as an ex-Muslim, as someone who have Muslim family members, as someone who lived in a Sharia country, and as someone who's living now in a non-Sharia country, as an activist and a campaigner, it never was a choice. It's not now. And it will never be, as long as it's the same Islamic ideology that's behind it. I'm not talking about the length and amount of clothes. I'm talking about the ideology. That's the same, you know, that's the whole segregation, no shaking, male guardians, dependency, and so on. I'm talking about the whole package. Hijab and its extreme version, niqab, are a way to control women bodies, to control women relationships, movements, and minds. And if you're worried, if there's any who are worried about compromising the right to choose, don't worry, because of course we all have the right to make decisions and take our own decisions, even bad ones. Don't worry, because women will still be able to make these decisions, but around the time they are allowed to choose to get their driving license and go around having sex madly. So they'll still have the right, yeah? The final thing, last but not least, is more free space for more space for freedom of thought and freedom of expression, and more support to those who are in the front lines, speaking on behalf of all of us, speaking and fighting on behalf of humanity. And we do know that there are a couple of people who are now in prisons and charged with apostasy because of their stance, Raif al-Badawi, Ashraf Fayyad, the 27 Qur'ani Muslims in Sudan who have been charged of apostasy, lots of others. And we need to support them as much as we can. The battle will continue. Hope you all have great holidays and Happy New Year.
Wow. Nahla Mahmoud, spokesperson for Council of Ex-Muslim. Now, talking about the front line, people on the front line. London Black Atheist Group, it's on the front line. They are actually fighting bigotry, religious sort of suppression that exists within communities in London. I'd like to ask Clive, Aruede, and Lola to know about to come and do a double act for us. Clive and Lola. Thank you.
Thanks very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to put Lola on first because as a true English gentleman, we always ask ladies to go first.
As we've been introduced, we're from the London Black Atheist. We started London Black Atheist about 3 years ago. We started London Black Atheist 3 years ago because of the problems we've identified in the black community, which are similar to the problems faced by the ex-Muslims. Probably not as extreme, but very close. A lot of black people is a very religious community. It's either you are a very strong Christian, I don't know whatever strong means, or you are a very strong Muslim, and there is no choice for free thinking, and there is no space for free thinkers. And if you reject religion, just like in the Muslim community, you are rejecting everything. You are rejecting your family, you are rejecting your society. Actually, you are seen as a traitor to the black community, because they think atheism or free thinking is a white, is a Western concept, and you are seen as sold out. So we formed the London Black Atheists to have a forum for support group. And the London Black Atheists, and a lot of, we have some of the ex-Muslims among us, we are not just a support group, we are becoming a family. I see Maryam as my sister. Thank you and well done for everything that you are doing. It is the love of humanity. It is not just loving ourselves as free thinkers, as atheists. It is loving the world, loving other human beings. When we speak up, today women in Saudi Arabia voted for the first time. It's because some people have spoken out. It's because people are relentless. We cannot give up. Today, I have to confess, I said to Clive, I'm worried about coming here. I don't know what will happen. But I just said to myself, whatever happens, I have to do this. I have to be here with Maryam and other people. Some people died so that we are not slaves. Some people died so that we can have freedom in Africa. And if it means the end of our life to have free, free speech, free thinking, secularism, so be it. And there's one thing I want to say, just one thing. We keep hearing about Islamophobia. Please, in 2016, can we say to the world, Christianity is not a race. Buddhism is not a race. Islam is not a race. No religion is a race. It is religion is thinking. Religion is ideology. People can change. In the Convention of Human Rights, certain things are stated as immutable characteristics. That has to be changed. You cannot persecute people on the basis of their religion. We do not persecute people on the basis of their religion, and we will not persecute people on the basis of living religion. However, no religion is a race. We have the right to change our mind. I cannot change my race, but I can change my religion. I can change my thinking. That is our fight for 2016. Let us not surrender to emotional blackmail. Thank you.
Thank you very much. 2015 has witnessed the Islamist attacks in Paris, Syria, Iraq, Nigeria, Cameroon, Pakistan, Chad, so many countries around the world, Bangladesh, and the list goes on and on, you know? And it seems impossible, almost impossible to stop it. But in fact, there are some hopeful signs, you know? Because ISIS has managed to piss off Putin, and you don't get away with that, you know? They've made a very, very powerful enemy in Russia. And, you know, they're gonna get exactly what is coming to them. Now, they've also attacked Paris twice, and also President Hollande has said he will not rest until they are destroyed. So, and even the British Prime Minister, David Cameron, our glorious leader, has stopped saying that Islam is the religion of peace. So there are some hopeful signs. And, you know, in years to come, we may look on 2015, bad as it is, but we may look on 2015 as being the year when the tide turned, and regard 2015 as the beginning of the end of Islamism. Whether it's the end of Islamism militarily, financially, or ideologically. And I would like you all to continue your hard work towards that end. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lola and Clive, for the double act. Well done. Now, Castle of Ex-Muslim sort of became a trend on Twitter. Thanks to Rayhana, Sultan, and her ideas. It actually was the idea behind the Castle of Ex-Muslim because, to explain why people are free thinking and leaving religion, I'd like to welcome Rayhana, human rights activist, animal rights activist, and a spokesperson for Castle of Ex-Muslim now. Thank you.
I joined Council of Ex-Muslims last year, and it was a massive realization for me that there are so many thousands of ex-Muslims around the world, across cultures and borders, and the idea that people are able to think freely and scrutinize idea can unite people across cultures and borders, and that was transforming for me. So I was working for a year, and there's a pattern in the eastern part of the world. If you criticize religion in countries like Bangladesh or Saudi Arabia, you get jailed and then you get prosecuted and discriminated because you're an atheist or you're an apostate. In the West, we have a problem of, you know, if we criticize Islam, we get labeled as racist and Islamophobic. And Maryam Namazie initially was disinvited, banned from talking at Warwick, and so there's a pattern of trying to silence criticism of Islam, especially in the West. So I spoke to Maryam and I said, I want to have a campaign to create awareness about how ex-Muslims are criticized in the East, in the West as well as in the East. It's like for the ex-Muslims, we don't have a safe space to talk about. So we launched a campaign, and it took off brilliantly. And it trended across at least 60 countries, and we had over 118,000 tweets in the last 21 days. And someone said that the hashtag ex-Muslim because was free speech at its finest. And if it wasn't for Maryam and the Council of Ex-Muslim, it probably wouldn't just remain an idea. But it was amazing. I think everyone in this room became a part of it. So thank you very much. And we've also seen tweets that said ex-Christians, ex-Jews, ex-New Agers, they also wanted a platform. That's really great. So next year, I'm also working with another friend, Benjamin David, who's here. And so we would be launching a charity called Freedom From Religion UK, which is an offshoot of Freedom of Religion in the United States. Mariam is on board with us as well as Kate. And that would be a platform not just for ex-Muslims, but for anyone from any religion or any community who supports free thinking, who supports scrutiny of ideas. So yeah, I'm just very nervous. So. Happy 2016, so thank you.
Thank you, Rayhana. Thank you. Now, when I was young, very young, I can't speak Arabic, but there was a music in a house on my console. And we could hear it in the background all the time. My grandmother used to listen to it, Arabic music. And it was the voice of, there's that sort of emotion for freedom and the voice of humanity in it, that you could, it doesn't matter whether you speak Arabic or not, you could hear it. And last night I was listening to Aliyah, Marquardt, and I could hear that voice. Voice that actually, I think, millions of people came out this year, early this year. It wasn't actually in the media much. A lot of people came for secularism and good times that people had in the past and hope for the future in Iraq, in Baghdad and Basra. And Aliyah Makra is going to sing for us Iraqi folk song and music, and we're going to welcome her to the stage now with her colleague, Keith Roth. Alex Roth on guitar. Now, I'd like you to actually bear with us, but you need to listen to this music and hear the voice of Iraq and humanity. Thank you.
Thank you all so much, and I do really appreciate your attention as well. I feel really privileged to be singing to a room of courageous people, and I know there's a lot of loss in this room as well. And I think one of the things, one of the processes that I've been through has been to find ways to reclaim what nourishes me from my culture, and what to leave away what doesn't nourish me. And everybody has that right to choose, to pick and choose what means something to them, what nourishes them, what speaks to their soul, and to put away what doesn't do that. It is not a package. It is up to you. And I think the music is something for me that I reclaim for myself and for us. So give us one moment while we just set up. We'll be about 5 seconds. One, two, one. This is the lovely Alex Roth. He's a Yid, but don't hold that against him. This first song is for Maryam. It's for the girl with eyes like almonds. Yeah. We sit under a tree and we flirt, Maryam. That's what we do. Yeah.
وأيام على الباب تعني
Song, I think, is the only time the word God is ever going to feature in this room. I think it's an important song for Arabia. It's an Arabic folk song, and it's about having hope in ordinary things. And although I think the default for Arabia is to seek God, I hope over time we'll be able to just seek it from each other and ourselves and rely on ourselves a bit more than surrender to something which never comes. So this is Al Halwadi.
الفكرية وديك بيدك كوكوكوكو بفقرية يا الله بنا على باب الله يا صناعية يقول صباحك صباح الخير يستطيع
last song, and this is after crude oil, I think, Iraq's biggest export, and we are going to be singing it in our own style. It's called Fogel Nachal. You probably heard it if you come from that part of the world. Anyway, this is Fogel Nachal, and thank you very much for being such a lovely audience, and thank you to Maryam, and thank you to everyone, all of you. I love you all. I love you all. Ensemble, And every penny from that goes to the Amal Foundation, which is a charity looking after Iraqis displaced within Iraq at the moment because of things we all know about. So if you want to buy one, it's £10 and it all goes to that charity. Come and see me. It's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. What beauty, huh? Thank you for Alex Roth and Aliyah Marquardt. Thank you very much. Maryam, your computer's arrived. We'd be happy to know. Thank you very much. Now, doesn't that sort of take your heart away? This is beautiful. How can we continue after this? I want to ask you to come back. Thank you very much. That was lovely and beautiful. Now, it's okay if the word feminist makes you feel uncomfortable, Kate said. I prefer the term radical, cunt-wielding, patriarchy smasher, Kate Smurthwaite, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much. Hello, it's lovely to be back. I know I've seen a lot of you either at one of these events before or like throughout the year because we tend to meet in the same places and the same situations. So I didn't want to just come here and do my sort of usual 10 minutes or even my sort of atheist-y 10 minutes. I thought I would do something a little bit different, which is to do a little kind of extract from my current solo show. And my current solo show is about being barred from Goldsmiths. Sound like a bit of a kind of familiar thing. And I have to say, massive kudos to Maryam. I am still barred from Goldsmiths, as far as we know. And when Maryam was booked and went and spoke there, she did ring me up the day before and ask if I wanted to be a warm-up act. So kudos for, unfortunately, I was working elsewhere, I couldn't. But and one of the reasons, now I should point out that this is part of an hour-long show, and if you ever see an hour-long comedy show, you'll be aware that there's a bit in the middle where you make some serious points, and it's not necessarily as funny as the rest. So this is going to be a mixture of some serious and some funny, but it is a little extract from my show, and there are a number of reasons given to me by Goldsmiths for my exclusion, and one of them was a word that's familiar to everybody in this room, Islamophobia. Because apparently I'm not allowed to hold the opinion that headscarves should be optional. That's too radical, it's too extreme. That, as we all know, is one of those wildly controversial opinions. And I was very offended that they would suggest that that was an extreme point of view or that would constitute this thing, Islamophobia. But I also was offended because if I have ever done anything that was Islamophobic, that definitely wasn't it. So last year, at the end of last year, I was asked to take part in a debate at Oxford University, at the Oxford Union. And the question under debate was whether Islam was compatible with feminism. And I said, I would love to go and argue, no, it's not. Mostly because I would get to shout at Adam Dean. And he was there arguing the opposite. But also, because I think it's an interesting thing to discuss. And now I got there, I took my partner with me, some of you know James, and when we got there, we were greeted by the Oxford University guest liaison officer, and he looked like the exhumed corpse of Richard III in snooker gloves. And he was very pleased to meet us, and he asked if we would like a tour of the union. And I said, actually, I went to Oxford. It was a long time ago, but I went to Oxford. I've been around the union, but you're very kind. And he was very excited that I was also a graduate. And he turned to my partner, James, and he went, oh, and which university did you go to? And I thought, oh, wait. Oh, wait. And James said, I didn't. I didn't go to university. And it was like you'd put salt on a slug. You could sort of see him grabbing his lapel, release the hounds. A member of the proletariat has breached the security perimeter. They were very worried. Then they were very disinterested in talking to James. And we went through to the debating chamber. And as one of the honoured guests, I was put at the front of the procession, and James was put at the back of the procession because he hasn't got a degree. But because they were so roundly ignoring him, James was able to do something rather interesting. He was able to sneak into the disabled toilet by the entrance to the debating chamber, and he emerged in a full burqa. And as many of you know, when you're wearing that item, this, he had the full, like, Saudi Arabian kind, absolutely everything covered, even the eyes. And when you're wearing that, no one can see who you are. So nobody thought anything apart from, well, that Muslim woman has a very flat-footed way of walking. There's nothing else you can say. And he went and sat in the third row of the debating chamber. And unfortunately, I was the last person to speak. So for the next 2.5 hours, I was getting text messages saying things like, I don't think I should have worn this over a suit. I think there was one that said, would it make your point if I died of heat exhaustion? And then I finally got to speak, and I talked about a few things, the idea of whether Islam and feminism are compatible. I quoted some verses that I'd looked up from the Quran that quite clearly state a woman's value to be less than that of her male relatives. And then I talked about countries like Saudi Arabia, where women are treated as second-class citizens, and Islam is directly given as the reason for that. And I said, well, look, if the book isn't equal and the practice isn't equal, it doesn't mean you can't make your way through it in your own way, but surely we can't call these things compatible. And I said, we have to talk about the burqa, don't we? There's like 30 places where it's compulsory to wear it. And if you don't want to wear it, I mean, that is a huge burden, isn't it? It obscures your vision, it obscures your hearing, it makes it harder to get around. And it erases your identity, all that individuality that I can see. I know I've come in jeans and a black t-shirt, comedian's uniform. I haven't really made a very good point, but many of you are wearing brightly coloured things, expressing yourself, even slogans and messages. And then I said, have you ever seen someone take one off? It's really kind of an amazing thing. And I think perhaps people in this room, perhaps you have. And perhaps, whereas a lot of people I interact with a lot of the time, perhaps never had. It's kind of an amazing thing to watch kind of a human being climb out of the shadow of a human being. It's amazing. And then I said, perhaps you, madam, in the third row. And they were very offended. They're not as offended as they were when the woman in the third row turned out to have a rather impressive beard. And after the debate, suddenly, having ignored James all evening, now everybody wanted to talk to James and ask him all sorts of questions, what he'd thought about it, what it felt like, whether he would want to do it again, this kind of thing. And so much interest was gathering about what we've been talking about, and then we decided to go to the Union Bar and continue our discussion in the Union Bar. When we got to the Student Union Bar, there behind the bar was an enormous sign that said this: Islam debate, cocktail special. And I'm sorry, but if anything is an insult to Islam, I'm pretty sure. Also, I have to say, this was the cocktail special: creme de menthe, vodka and lemonade. Like, I am not a massive expert on the Quran, but I'm pretty sure there is no verse that says Allah is mighty and verily those that follow him, shall their cocktails be indistinguishable from mouthwash. But so that's just a little extract of my show. We're really hoping to go back and do it at Goldsmiths, because obviously now I've written a show about Goldsmiths. And on that front, I'm starting a new campaign. It's lovely to be involved with so many things that you guys are doing. But I am also starting a new campaign to have Benjamin David installed as the head of the student union at Goldsmiths. I think that needs fixing, sorting out. And I hope to see you all again next year. Have a fantastic Christmas.
Thank you, Kay. Thank you. Now, early in the week, a group of women went to Downing Street to hand in a petition and a letter to David Cameron to review the role of Sharia courts in Britain. And one of those was Gita Sahgal, from Centre for Secular Space. She's a human rights activist, well-known advocate for freedom of expression and women's rights. Gita Sahgal, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh gosh, it looks amazing from here, seeing all of you and seeing a lot of old friends, but also seeing new faces. And that's the amazing thing about the Council for Ex-Muslims. They're always new faces here as well. And they're all the older ones who are here. They're the older well, not old like me, but people who've been around the Council for a while, who come here, as we've been hearing, with their triumphs. Because however horrific the things that happened during the year have been, what we can say is that the reason the council was set up, which was to create space to help free speech, to be able to analyze things, to be able to laugh, to be able to have fun, to have some joy, to listen to music, all those things are happening. And I think the key thing about the Goldsmiths debate is that it happened. It happened when a new society, AHS, and they're here today, and I really congratulate them, decided that they would invite Maryam. Well, I'd been there just the week before, but to my great distress, when the union analyzed whether I should be allowed to come, they decided that I would cause no alarm or distress, and therefore there was no problem with my coming. I was extremely upset about that. So, but the point about that, of course, is that I'm a kafir anyway, and it's the apostates that get chased. It's all of you who are apostates, who are the ones who the Islamic societies and so on go after. And that is the difference between us. Although we stand shoulder to shoulder, there is that difference. So we're coming up for the 16th of December, and that is a very key date that many of you may not know. And it's in 1971, it was the date when Bangladesh achieved its liberation, when the Indian Army, the Pakistan Army surrendered to the Indian Army and the liberation forces of Bangladesh. That, very, very long ago, was a just war where a country was invaded because an elected government had not been allowed to take its place, and where the liberation forces of Bangladesh took up arms to fight for their freedom, and the Indian Army came in to support that and restored an elected government and left the country. That is...
Correction, surrendered to joint forces of India and Bangladesh.
Yes, I said beside, yes.
I have to correct, I'm in Bangladesh.
Yeah, I said the Indian Army with the liberation forces. That is a crucial point, Arif, and that is the whole point about it, that there was a liberation army that had been fighting all along. On 16th of December last year, a Peshawar school, an army school, was attacked. And the two dates have this significance because many in Pakistan are in such denial about the jihadis that their own country has created. And Bangladesh in 71, long before the war on terror, long before other Western interventions, was a sign of one of the first modern jihads with the current, the Islamists that are current now and have been nurtured in Britain. In the 16th of December, the Taliban attacked an army school and picked off deliberately army children. And a lot of people thought that India had done this in Pakistan. And they said, the 16th of December is the date, that's why India must have done it. But for India, it was a victory that they don't need to celebrate by massacring people in another country. For Pakistan and for the Taliban, it is a defeat they still remember, which the army was responsible for. And that caused huge public revulsion in Pakistan, which has strengthened the secular movement, which is nevertheless under enormous threat in Pakistan, because of course the response of the Pakistani state was to start hanging people for terrorism, blasphemy law, arrests continued, and justice was militarized. So people in those countries are fighting multiple threats at the same time. And of course we have the connections with Paris, because the links between blasphemy and apostasy and shutting down people and shutting down debate and mass violence, such as we see happening all across the world, all those things are intricately linked up. Now in India, I mean, I spend a lot of my time defending people who have a religion, defending Christians when their churches are burnt down, defending Muslims who are under attack in the subcontinent. And at this moment in India, we have a fascist government, the Hindutva Party, which is exactly the same thing as the Islamist parties. And that's in power in India. And we talked about it when Maryam organized the secularism conference last year. And my mother is campaigning along with thousands of other people against the atmosphere intolerance. She's a writer. At least 40 writers have given up their awards because the Literary Academy wasn't protesting about censorship. Rationalists are being killed, 3 rationalists, some of them this year, some of them a year or so ago, have been killed by armed men. The other people are under attack. They're having to withdraw their writings. Everything that we know that goes on in Islamist contexts is happening in India now, and that is seen as an ally of Cameron. And what do we have? We have British commentators saying, oh, well, nothing very much is happening because there hasn't been a major pogrom yet. Well, there hasn't been a pogrom because people have stood up against it. Students have stood up against it. Students are protesting, not the science students whose universities were taken over by crazy fundamentalists. They didn't protest in the technology colleges, but the film students mounted a massive public protest against, you know, third-rate people just because of their political connections taking over their institutions. So it is on your shoulders. And don't get depressed when you start being, some of us who've been around for a while know that we're going to be called all sorts of horrible names, racists, Islamophobes, and all the rest of it. And it doesn't matter. It's a badge of honor, as long as we know that what we're fighting for is universalism and universal rights. And that's what we're going to carry on doing next year. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And one of those who's been fighting for the women's rights in Kurdistan has been Houzan Mahmoud, my dear friend, who also spoke for the first time, I think, in London Feminist Conference this year, along with Gita and Maryam and others. Thank you, Houzan Mahmoud.
Thank you so much, Fariborz and Maryam, for inviting me. First of all, I apologize because my voice is really annoying. I'm not well, but I just came here today to say that I'm in solidarity with you, Maryam, especially after what happened in Goldsmiths. It was, in my opinion, terrifying, and it's a continuation of forced Islamification of all spaces that people like us want to exist and to have a voice. I don't really look at that as a matter of being an Islamophobe or being a tolerant person towards Islam and so on and so forth. It's all nonsense. In my opinion, wherever Islamists exist and turn Islam or any other religion into a politicized movement or politicized ideology or political parties and groups, that is no longer individual religion. That is no longer a faith whereby ordinary people can continue and follow with. I think ISIS and Al-Qaeda and groups before them and the ones that come after them, they are a disgrace to ordinary Muslims as well. It's not only us who have been labeled as Islamophobes. Millions of ordinary Muslims are rejecting ISIS to be representing them. So they are Islamophobes as well then. I mean, I really want to find the person who created this stupid term, this silly term, Islamophobia, and just to tell them, I'm sorry. You know, when you see people being beheaded and killed and raped and sold into sexual slavery, you can't just speak out against that because it's against, it's offensive to Muslims. You have to make a distinction between dignified, ordinary people who follow any religion as a matter of their own choice, but also those who are making, who are abusing this belief system and using it for political gains and to force it on people across the world. Today I was reading the news in Sweden. Swedish people received letters in their homes with ISIS signatures saying, you either convert or you pay tax or you will be beheaded or your houses will be blown up. I mean, this is the kind of terror that they will bring to your own home. This speaking out against that is not a phobia. Phobia is a stupid term. It's about, yeah, you are scared of something that you don't know. No, we don't know what we are scared of. We know what we are talking about, and we know why we are up against it here and in Kurdistan and in Iraq and Syria and everywhere else. I mean, let's not forget what ISIS did. I mean, the only good thing about 2015 so far to me is because it's two times where we defeated ISIS in Kurdistan, one in Rojava and the second time in Shingal. And the good thing and the best thing out of that were Kurdish women who actually played a very key role in defeating ISIS, because Kurdish people or women in particular, everywhere they know what living under Islam means, what living under Sharia law means. It is disgraceful. It is discriminatory. I mean, I cannot find words to describe how horrible it is. I myself grew up in a Peshmerga family. I'm Kurdish from Iraq, and my family were all up in arms against Saddam's fascist regime. And now the new generation are up in arms against Islamic fascism of ISIS. I mean, it seems like every new time, every new era, a new form of fascism comes. One under Arab nationalism or fascism, and then under Islamic fascism, and they all want to force everybody to think like them, to talk like them, to believe like them. These are all forms of failed ethnocentric, racist, fascist nation states in the Middle East that they were actually a result of colonization. Groups who come out, who come up to power in many countries across the Middle East after the ending of colonialism, they gave revolutionary legitimacy to themselves by killing and preventing lots of other ethnic minorities and religions and others just to say this is one pure nation state. This is bullshit. There is not such a thing as a pure nation or a pure religion that everybody has to be like that or talk like that or think like that. People by nature are diverse. Today I am Islam, tomorrow I am atheist, the other day I might convert to Christianity, hopefully not, that would be my total failure, but people are changing, human beings are changing, religions, languages, nationalities, all these kind of things are human constructs, these are social constructs, we construct them. Religion is a man-made, specifically in the case of Islam. It is a purely man-made in the interest of men. That's why today, into this age, it cannot be changed. It cannot be changed. It will stay like that. It will remain like that. The only way forward is to turn everywhere into a front line to fight against ISIS ideology, but also against forced Islamization of all spaces, be it our homes, our schools, our universities, and our streets. I mean, that's the only really way forward. I mean, when people tell me, oh, moderate Islam or fanatic Islam, I just think this is so stupid. It's like going to an Indian restaurant and saying, oh, do you want mild curry or hot curry? Well, I'm sorry, religion is not like that. It's not a pot of curry that you choose it mild or spicy or hot. I just leave religion the way it is and read it and look at it and criticize it. All religions, when you bring them into power, they are worse than hot curries, you know? You just have to treat them as religions. You know what I mean? Although I love my curry to be hot, to be honest with you. But that is the problem. I mean, look at ISIS. ISIS is just... You know, people forgot about Al-Qaeda and other forms of terrorism before because ISIS is actually using new technologies, new techniques of how to kill and burn and grill people and behead them and sell them and turn them into sexual slaves and objects. It's just crazy. People forgot about other forms of Islamic organizations and they all talk about ISIS. There's no such a thing as moderate Islamic groups or Islamic parties. If you bring Islam or any religion into the public space, sorry, it is no longer religion. It is a political movement, and it will be so dangerous not to fight it the way it is and not to speak it and not to name it the way it is. So let's be in solidarity with those who are really, really up in arms in the front line, Kurdish people, Kurdish Peshmerga, female fighters, and to all of us across the world, no matter what languages or nationalities we are or we are actually forced to be, we should stay in solidarity with each other until we defeat this ISIS phenomenon. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Houzan Mahmoud. Ah, she had sore throat, she couldn't speak. Can I ask, we haven't got much time actually, got a couple of more speakers. Before we finish, I'd like to ask Imad al-Din Habib, the founder of the Council of Ex-Muslims in Morocco, and then that will follow with Magdalene in a minute. But Imad, could you come and join me for a minute? Yes, thank you. I knew you would say that. Thank you.
Well, hi everyone. I'm very happy to be here and to see the old faces and the new faces. I mean, around 10 years ago, 11 years ago, they left Islam, and they've been nothing in the internet. I've studied in a Quranic school, and I've been reading in this Tabari book where this guy, well, Tabari claims that one guy being killed, assassinated by ghosts, and they wrote poetry claiming his assassination because he just used to pee in the street, and it never made sense to me, and I never found anything else in the books that made sense with anything as common sense or reason. And now, 10 years after that, we have the Council of Ex-Muslims and all over that, where there is a space for people to speak about religion, there's forums, there's magazines, and I think this is a very positive thing. Now, let's see the negative things. We have a horde of well-funded Islamist organizations all around the world who all what they do since 14 centuries is to try to put people into doing things in the name of Islam. This is the pure Islam, they say, and you should follow it. And not just us ex-Muslims that are fed up with that, but only as well, so many Muslims who want to leave Islam their own way. They want maybe to apply things, not to apply things. They want to have their own interpretations. And when it comes to Islam, it's not about a moderate interpretation or the radical or a whatever interpretation. But it's about agreeing that a religion has no place in a legal system, religion has no place in education, religion has no place in politics, whether it is true or not. We need to be in a system where all of us, regardless of our religion and ethnicities, can live together beyond the whatever revelations is. I'm here today to ask you all to help us form this amazing, amazing job that Maryam and many others are doing to stand in front of Islamic fundamentalism and other kinds of fundamentalism that they have petrodollar with them, they have the United Nations, the chair of human rights, council somehow. They have so many countries, 57 Islamic countries in this world that are funding this message of intolerance, this message of fundamentalism, where people are tried on apostasy just for questioning Hadith, questioning Sunnah, questioning any aspect of Islam. Any aspect of Islamic countries has become somehow a taboo. And people who are on the front line are being targeted with terrorist attacks, targeted by hateful campaigns, targeted and marginalized by the West as being somehow Islamophobic or racist, or maybe it's not the right time to speak about all those people languishing in prison. Maybe it's not the right time to speak about all those people, all those women, all those children who suffer in silence, whether in Islamic communities here in the West or in Islamic countries where people, if maybe they're atheists and all that, they can go to jail, they can be executed, they can end up in mental institution and so forth. So I really hope that we can do something. I'm not very optimistic, but I really hope that with all those well-funded Islamic organizations, we can do something against that and just stand as a voice for reason, at least in history. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mark, for that optimistic note. Right, among us, some people who epitomize resistance, clear thinking, and bravery. And I'd like to welcome a Libyan women's rights activist and campaigner, Magdalena Beda. Magdalene.
Hello, everybody. I think everybody's talked about everything, and I don't know really what to talk about. But I'm just remembering when I was a child growing up in a country that was under sanction. Libya was really isolated from the whole world. And the only thing I know about Islamism was Taliban. And Taliban in Arabic, for us, it means two students. And we were joking, like, Taliban is doing bombing all killing all of these people, what a whole class is going to do. And we didn't really know what's going on in the world outside until the late 90s when the civil war in Algeria started. And all of a sudden, our school curriculum changed. And this fear of Islamism and new lectures starting about Islam and Islamism and how we should be afraid about these monsters. And so until now, I have phobia from Algeria. I'm sorry, I know some Algerian people are here. But really, this is how the regime at that time represented Algeria and connected with Islamism and these monsters who killing people out in the street. So until, of course, in 2006, the sanction was removed from Libya, and suddenly we were famous all over the world. People before didn't really know Libya, and they only knew Gaddafi. So during Gaddafi times, we really didn't feel like we need to fight for women's rights, because basically we did have everything we wanted. I mean, we didn't feel oppressed. We wore whatever we want to wear. We went to any school. We worked in any field. We had military school for women. We actually, military was compulsory for women before you have, after you graduate, before going to have a job, you have to do 2 months of military, and actually we had to learn how to use the weapon and drive tanks in the high school. So it was it was so military, and we didn't really feel the difference until 2011, when the regime was overthrown and the Islamism took over the country, and they start changing laws that we really took it for granted. We didn't know that when we have such a regime, Islamic regime, all women's rights will change. It was just in a sudden, in a time of 2 years, women couldn't travel alone without mahram, which is a male companion. Women wouldn't be able to go in the street safely. The laws like for marrying a second wife changed, because during Gaddafi times it was prohibited unless your wife had to go to the court and she says in front of the judge, well, I accept him marrying a second wife, otherwise you wouldn't be able, and if you did according to Islamic laws, like, you know, under the table, your children will be illegitimate. So yeah, and this changed after, like, in 2011, everything Libya started to be a really horrible place for women, and that's when we started our campaign for women's rights. In 2012, we had me and my other friends, we started an organization called Haqqi, which is my right, for women's rights. We went in the street and we start talking about women's rights and to stop changing the existing laws. We had to fight for the existing laws that we really never thought that it's just there, it's as a default. And we never thought that we will have a time that we will go to the street and say, we don't change these laws. So yeah, political Islam is really, really dangerous for human rights, for women rights in particular, because women are oppressed in Islamic laws. I mean, there's this famous sentence everywhere now in the media. Says, today I just heard it from one guy who was talking about schools, illegal schools. Well, they are not really Islam. They are not teaching Islam. Islam is not like that at all. But I mean, at the end of the day, who you are to say what's Islam and what's not? I mean, Islam is what's implemented. At the end of the day, people would implement things or understand it according to their human nature, according to their logic, or so on. But what it's really is, it's something different. Because when you say it's not Islam, it's not Islam. It's not Islam for you. It's that, because I believe until we actually admit that there are things in this religion that's wrong, and then we can go forward. Saying that this is not Islam doesn't really change anything, and we cannot go forward. And especially, like, at the end of the day, us as ex-Muslims or other people, the Islam is not it's not a big deal for us, because these laws are not going to be implemented on us. It's women, Muslim women, who are in these countries suffering every day because of Islamic Sharia laws, that's being oppressed, have to be obedient in their homes. If they were beaten by their husbands and they try to run away, they have to come back by the marital captivity law, which is beta-ta in Islamic religion. Islamic courts are really, really dangerous. I mean, Muslim women have no way to go out of these laws as long as it's implemented on them. There will never be rights for them. And I really hope that this thing will be changed. And I mean, especially in country. Like, we escaped from Islamic countries and we come here and to find Islamic clothes. I mean, excuse me. We left the whole countries for you and you are bringing things over here. And I really thought that this place would be a paradise for us, but it's not. We still have to fight for it. And the other day on the train, I was reading this book. It was an autobiography about Billie Holiday, and she was speaking about her husband. She said, "Oh, I've always been a religious bitch, but if this guy believes in God, I'm thinking it over." And to be honest, these people, religious fanatics, they also help us in our fight, because they're setting an example of what is religion can be. And that's how we're going to fight. And when we speak about Islamism, they represent it. And this is how they are helping us to fight this religion. Thank you very much, and a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you. Thank you very much, Magdalene. Council of Ex-Muslim is growing in different parts of the world, as well as in Britain as well. I'd like to ask Ramin Forghani to come in, who is from a Council of Ex-Muslim in Scotland, to say a very brief message, very short one. Where is Ramin? There he is. He's changed. He hasn't got dreadlocks anymore. Here we go. Thank you. Well,
in continuous that what you were saying about Libya, I should say that 3 years ago, when the elections were going on in Iran, people were saying that, oh, that's so amazing that Mr. Rouhani is elected moderate president. 3 days ago, a woman was sentenced to death by stoning in Iran. So, yeah. And about 2015, the year passed. It was a disastrous, it was a sad year for individual rights. It was a year that people who were hanging out in pubs were murdered in Paris, less than a year after Charlie Hebdo. When we were defending Charlie Hebdo, we were accused of Islamophobia, being against Islam and those sort of stuff. I think it brings in mind that in West, the term politically correctness is really the time that politicians need to rethink it and redefine this term. I think it's something that is destroying liberalism, it's destroying individual rights, it's destroying freedom of speech. Raf Badawi was sentenced to death, and then later on his sentence was changed to 10 years in prison, 1,000 lashes. His first sentence was implemented in January 2015. Nothing happened. Politicians in West gave statements, as they do usually, always, but no real action. Nobody came up saying that, okay, that's enough, you need to stop doing this, or either, unless, I don't know, we stop dealing with you financially, and there are routes to stop them, but they didn't. We had a good news in in Scotland. We had our first female member in October. It was a good thing that we had in Glasgow going on. In October, I was planned to speak in Netherlands in two events regarding a documentary that the Dutch Humanist Association produced about non-believers. That was filmed in London and Turkey and a few other countries. I was also planned to speak at the Dutch Parliament in Hague in support of the freedom of report, Freedom of Thought, that was produced by International Humanist Association, but the authorities didn't facilitate my travel documents, so I couldn't be able to be there. I say that, and there are other examples that ex-Muslims are not being supported. They're not being supported. At the same time, they are being indirectly prevented from defending freedom of speech and freedom of ex-Muslims, as we saw the events that went on with Maryam this year. So it was a very sad year, and I hope that the coming year will be better.
Thank you, Robin. Now, there's been, although we've heard harrowing sort of stories, but really the extent and reach of the Council of Ex-Muslim is great, and it's actually bringing to attention a lot of changes that is taking place, and that's the important momentum is being created. Before Maryam Namazie speaks, I'd like to ask Usher, the president of the ASH from Goldsmiths University, to come and join us. Come on. You did great work. Come on and stand here. There we go. You want to say a few words?
Thank you all. I haven't actually prepared anything, but as you said, I'm the president. We've been talked about quite extensively tonight, so I'm sure you're all aware of what happened with Maryam. I think that it is exceptionally important to trumpet and be a champion of opinions such as Maryam's, and for any skeptical or dissenting opinion for that matter at all. And if universities can't be bastions of the free exchange of ideas, as has happened at Warwick and at Goldsmiths University with Maryam and Kate for that matter, then we have no hope that we can have the free exchange of ideas at any other institution. We have to start at universities and places of education. I'd like to also extend my offer to Kate to come back to you. Yeah. Yeah. At least if you're not too put off by the events of late. And thank you all for the outpouring of support that we have had over the last few days. It's greatly appreciated and is very... Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now, we've got a lot of work to do. You've heard a lot. Possibilities, there's a lot to change, and struggle is beautiful, you know, despite all the difficulties that we have. And who else apart from Maryam Namazie to be able to epitomize that for us? Thank you, Maryam. Here we go.
Thank you very much. It's so great to be with all of you to celebrate the end of a good year and not so good year, and also to look forward to the future. Obviously, when we are looking at the year that passed, we cannot help but remember all of those people who we've lost, beloved from Paris to many, many cities, marketplaces, even mosques and schools in countries across the world, from Nigeria to Pakistan to Iraq and Mali, you name it. For many people across the world, every day is a Paris, and we have to remember that. Not just because of Islamist terrorism, but also because of Sharia laws. You know, 19-year-old Rokhshana, who is no longer amongst us because she was stoned to death for love in Afghanistan. Someone like Shahrukh Zamani, a labor activist in Iraq, who was found dead in his prison cell in Iran. And of course, we have so many heroes who are languishing in prison because they dare to speak, they dare to think, they dare to say no to oppression. wonderful heroes like Raif Badawi, who is on hunger strike right now, who is facing 10 years in prison and 1,000 lashes merely for raising the question of religion and politics. We have to remember that as we stand here today and as we struggle for rights and for free thinking today, that our lives and our rights and our hopes are all intrinsically linked with those who are fighting across the world, in the Middle East and North Africa, in South Asia, in some of the smallest villages and some of the biggest cities across the world. The far right, who hates all Muslims and all immigrants, who place collective blame on all of us for Islamism's crime, will even call someone like myself, who's an ex-Muslim, as an undercover jihadi, just because we dare to tell them that we oppose their racism and their bigotry, and that we will not tolerate collective blame on masses of people, many of whom are just, you know, dying on our borders for a life that can be relatively free. And of course, the likes of The Guardian, who tell us that we're antisocial and even dangerous. Yeah, it's true. Ayatollah BBC, who tells us that it's not the right time for us to raise our issues. It's never the right time for them. Everywhere we go, we are called inflammatory and controversial. Why? Why are we the ones who are inflammatory and controversial? We are the ones defending humanity in this day and age. It's the Islamists who are inflammatory and controversial. They are the bringers of death and destruction. And we are the ones who are trying to bring lightness and freedom for all of us. I think when we look at what's happening today with what the, you know, the likes of The Guardian, the likes of the far right say, we realize that there is a political fight going on, something that Maryam Helleloukis said, the Algerian sociologist. There is a fight going on, and a lot of these groups and people on the left, many of them on the left, some on the far right, they don't acknowledge that this fight exists. They only see Islamists, and they see us through Islamist eyes. They see dissent through Islamist eyes. But the reality is that we are all here today because we see ourselves through other eyes, the eyes of dissenters. And we aren't afraid. Some people call us courageous, some people call us brave, but there are so many of us that, you know, one thinks that, why do we get that sort of label when there are so many like us? And I think it is important for us to see that what we do here today is linked to the fight of so many across the world, and that gives us more courage, that gives us more hope. I do believe that what we do has an impact. It will change the world for the better. It has to. We owe it to all those who we've lost. We owe it to ourselves, to future generations. We must live in a world where we can be rid of Islamism. And everything we do matters. So I want to thank you for standing up, for being counted, for being heard. It does make a difference. Never feel alone. I met a woman today who's been ostracized by her family. Where is she? And I'm sorry that one has to go through this just to be able to live as one chooses. But don't feel ostracized, don't feel alone, because there are millions of us. And as the ex-Muslim, because hashtag showed, you know, people felt that, you know, they were astonished. We were astonished. There are so many more than we can believe. And we are many. We are the innumerable. We are the millions that Islamism actually fears. If they didn't fear us so much, they wouldn't need to put bombs in marketplaces and cities. They are afraid of us. And don't ever forget that. Thank you.
Thank you, Maryam Namazie, well done. That brings us this year's party, shall we call it? Have more drinks to end. But before we go, as Maryam said, there are a lot of activities going on. There are refugees in Calais,
Are people actually collecting clothes because it's winter is coming? Somebody in about 2 weeks' time going to Cali with loads of warm clothes. If you want to donate, Jalil is here who can get your details. Somebody's going to Cali in about 2 weeks' time. We'll be collecting some warm clothes for refugees in Cali. Don't forget to buy the CD here. £10 each is going to go to AMA Foundation, which is supporting Yazidis in Iraq, who actually been displaced in their own country. So please make sure. Don't forget to drink more. There's bar after 6 o'clock down the stairs. The more you drink, the less we have to pay. So carry on. And also, there's a donation box here. Who would like, if you like, after all those things, you'd like to donate to work of Council of Ex-Muslims and One Door for All, we'll appreciate it. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you very much for people who actually supported today and the speakers. Beautiful music from Aliyah and Alex Roth. And thank you to all of you for today. On board to 2016. Drink a lot. Enjoy yourself. There's a lot to do. Thank you. Well done. Thank you. Bye. Thank you.